The next is what is called laziness. Let me practice yoga from tomorrow. This is the formula of the wonderful fellow. Tomorrow he wakes up very early in the morning by 9:30 and then says to himself, better luck tomorrow. And then one of his friends advises to him most inconveniently that he should have an alarm watch, and then he has the alarm clock near his bed within the reach of his hand. Then the alarm is faithful. It is as faithful as a experienced yogi. And then this fellow wants to believe that he is not conscious and he has stopped the watch. He wants to stop the watch, but he wishes to believe that he is unconscious, that he has done it unconsciously. So better luck next day. That means better luck next birth. This is one of the major obstacles Patanjali explained. And the next one is not having a hold upon yoga practice for a very long time. Even though everything is perfect in his practice, everything is done in mechanical perfection, you can never point out any defect in his way of doing things. And at the end of 20 years, you will find the fellow as he was. What is the reason? Only one thing. He has no enthusiasm in doing it. The very first principle, that is, repetition of the idea that he should become better, it's not there. So the fellow lost his enthusiasm to practice yoga, and continuing it mechanically, just like a machine. A machine runs in perfection, but there is no consciousness in the machine. There is no enthusiasm in the machine. This is what happens if we have no spirit of doing things. If we do not throw the light of our devotedness to our practice. We are not devoted to the practice. We believe that the practice should be useful to us, and we never believed that our practice is more valuable than ourselves. That means we are never prepared to offer ourselves to yoga. We want only to offer yoga to ourselves. So the whole thing is a waste. And the next thing, no continuity of effort. This is the last obstacle Patanjali enumerates. Unless we have a continuity of purpose, we cannot continue. We may not be lazy, we may not be unhealthy, we may not be insincere, but we have no purpose in life. Then it goes a waste. These are the obstacles which we cannot overcome by ourselves. And these obstacles can be overcome by starting the practice of the uttering of the sacred word. And if you are able to overcome any of these obstacles existing in you, then understand that your practice of the utterance of the sacred word is running on correct lines. Not only these obstacles, there are more dangerous and stronger psychological obstacles of a different nature. They are called greater impediments. For example, sorrow. After practicing yoga for about 10 or 15 or 20 years, suppose there is a tragic incident and a big sorrow in life. That is the end of the practice of yoga for that life. The curtain drops before the drama is completed. And only in the next birth he has to continue. Such things also will be overcome if we begin to practice uttering Om daily. Because it is very, very difficult to overcome this obstacle called sorrow. Suppose there is a death in the family. That puts an end to many sequences occurring in the family. The next thing, next example he gives is depression, mental depressions. One fellow lost all his money in business. He is depressed and he can never recover. Previously he was practicing yoga for 10 years. Then there is a cutoff of yoga practice for that life. Any obstacle is there to create the depression in mind. And the next one is called a minor obstacle. That is the movement of the body. Whenever a movement of the body is made, the mind is disturbed of yoga practice. That's why we are expected to practice sitting without any movement of any part of the body for hours together. And after a certain time, we reach a stage when we are not disturbed, even though we are walking on the street. But in the earlier stages, even the movement of any part of the body also causes an impediment.